one is the effect it has on population patterns of Black Americans. So during World War One, as we already discussed, there was a major demand for laborers. And since there are so many job opportunities during World War One, many African Americans move out of the South for one of the first times after the period of Reconstruction. We know that they were very much limited to sharecropping careers during the Reconstruction era into the late 19th century. But finally, during the period between World War One and the Great Depression, you have this major population shift called the Great Migration. As you can see here, most of the places that the former Black Southern population moved to were in the Northeast and also the Midwest, but you also did have some Black Americans actually migrate to Western states as well. What's important is, for the most part, these Black Americans would move to places where they already had some sort of community network or kinship connection. So you would move to a place when you already had family members there. There were hopes and dreams that they would have very high-paying jobs, but just like some women experienced during World War One, many Black migrant workers actually ended up settling for very low-paying jobs, so things like janitors, porters. There were also signs of white outrage because of the Black migration, and you did have some riots against Black workers in these cities. So of course, these Black migrants were met with a lot of resistance from the white community. So, you know, just like we saw during the Civil War with the New York City draft riots of 1863, the change in population pattern and the influx of a new population is going to be seen as a threat. Mostly by the part of the population that is working in those low-paying jobs. You are going to have a sense of disillusionment among many Black people who thought that their wartime service was going to get them treated better. They thought that these increased job opportunities would help them get paid more. And so you do sometimes have many Black Americans after the war is over, that sort of disillusionment fuels them to a certain extent with a sense of militancy, and also to a certain extent with a drive to become more active in Black empowerment. And so the NAACP, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, that was created by W.E.B. Du Bois around the turn of the 20th century, is going to experience an increased membership during the World War One era, because many, many Blacks are upset that they haven't made more progress. After the war's over, there's going to be a serious disruption in that kind of sense of security that laborers felt. Of course, when you have peace in Europe, you're going to have Europeans return to the industrial workforce. And so the demand for American products is going to decline. And so there isn't going to be as many jobs available for soldiers who are returning home. Also, as we said before, the people who rose up to take on those jobs when many male soldiers went abroad were then going to find themselves out of work. You're also going to have an increase of inflation. You're going to have an increased non-recognition of unions. Working conditions are going to become poor. And as I said before, there's a general concern about job security. So there's going to be a lot of labor unrest after the war is over. The best example of this is that in 1919 alone, you had 3,600 strikes that involved over 400 million workers. And one of the biggest strikes was called the Steel Strike of 1919. Over 350,000 workers got together and decided to strike, but the strike still ended up failing, which shows us that workers are now again in a position of much less empowerment. The war provided them with a temporary elevated status, which very quickly went away once the war ended. When Germany surrenders in 1918, the next thing, of course, that all these European powers, as well as the United States, have to deal with is how to draw peace terms. And so the Treaty of Versailles is decided upon by delegates from 27 countries The people, the countries who dominate the Versailles Conference are Britain, France, Italy, and the United States. And Wilson, in particular, comes up with a detailed plan of 14 different points. Each of these points was a provision that articulated Wilson's vision of peace. You can see the points down here. You don't need to know all of them. But if you look at some of them here, realize that many of them are promoting a sense of self-determination among other countries, the idea that individual countries should have more autonomy to govern themselves. There also very much was an attempt to rekindle free trade and to disarm the seas, right? So freedom of the seas suggests that, right? Because of course we know that in the years prior to the American involvement in World War I, merchant ships, passenger ships were threatened by military confrontation, and so Wilson wanted that to stop. Wilson also saw the 14 points as sort of a moral mission. He saw this as a way to achieve long-standing permanent peace. The World War I was actually called many times the war to end all wars, which we know is obviously very ironic now. But in a lot of ways, Wilson's 14 points were, they remind us that Wilson still very much was a progressive. That to him, he sees the 14 points as a way to ensure more global stability, a long-standing period of peace, and this is very much a progressive ideal. The major point, the 14th point, is one of the most important ones, and that was Wilson's envisioning of an organization called the League of Nations, which you can see as essentially like the United Nations. It would be an organization of many countries, and their goal would be to essentially be a collective security organization. And their goal would be to maintain stability throughout the world. There were many critics of the League of Nations. Many of them argued that having this type of collaboration would diminish U.S. sovereignty and control in foreign affairs. And we're going to see in a moment that the League of Nations eventually will fail, and the United States never even joins it. So Wilson's plans for peace do not actually materialize. One of the reasons why they don't is because the Treaty of Versailles was incredibly harsh on Germany. There was this, there's this very, very clear pattern in all of the provisions of the treaty that make it clear that the Allies who won wanted to punish Germany as the sole arbiter of the war. They smacked Germany with billions of dollars of war reparations that it took them decades to pay off. All the other countries involved in the Versailles Conference basically carved out Germany to try to basically take control of all the lands of the beaten Central Powers. In terms of imperialism, the Allies seized control of all the former German colonies in places like Africa. So we see that Wilson's goals for peace in the 14 points are not what countries like France and Britain were going after. They very much wanted Germany to swallow the bitter pill of the Treaty of Versailles, which was incredibly harsh. So Wilson was not very happy at all with the compromises, or lack thereof, I guess, of the final Treaty of Versailles, but he does feel when he goes home that if he can get the Senate to support the League of Nations, that he has been successful. But when he goes home, he realizes that most of the members of Congress are actually not very keen on the League of Nations. Part of this is because by this point, the Republicans have regained control of Congress. And as we remember, Wilson was a Democrat. And so many senators directly oppose American participation in any peace treaty. Some of these Republicans were isolationists. Some of them were just blatant xenophobes. And they were led by the Senate Majority Leader, Henry Cabot Lodge, a Republican from Massachusetts. And his belief was that the League of Nations would impinge on American autonomy. And so basically, because of Henry Cabot Lodge's opposition, he rallies most Republicans in Congress behind him, and they refuse to support the League of Nations. Also, the U.S. refuses to sign the Treaty of Versailles. So what we have here is Congress completely opposing Wilson's plans for peace. In a lot of ways, we see this as one stubborn president against a very stubborn group of congressmen. Wilson calls all the members of Congress that oppose his ideas irreconcilables. Wilson actually goes on a long speaking tour to try to muster up support for the League of Nations, and he actually suffers a stroke when he's on his tour. He is essentially very, very ill for the rest of his presidency. For the first time in history, his wife, Edith Wilson, actually essentially rules as president in his stead, because there was not a very clear understanding about the role of the vice president in a situation like this. So the takeaway is that this failure to compromise between Wilson and Congress means the U.S. never signs the Treaty of Versailles, and it never joins the League of Nations. And the League of Nations is eventually going to fail, and some people say that it's because the U.S. was not involved in the League of Nations. So this cartoon here demonstrates the idea that the USA would be the keystone that would keep the League of Nations intact, and without that keystone, the entire bridge would fall. Another major thing that was taking place towards the tail end of the war is that Russia was undergoing its own internal revolution. This was called the Bolshevik Revolution, which was where the working class, or the Bolsheviks, overthrew the Mensheviks, the middle or upper classes. So it was a major victory for socialists and Marxists in Russia, but it was a huge upset of the long-standing social order. The ruling family, the Romanovs, were murdered, every single one of them, including the children and all of the servants. It was a major disruption to the status quo in Russia. So the Bolshevik victory sort of changed the climate of the approach towards Russia in the war, in the sense that, remember that Russia was one of the allies of Britain, France, and the United States. And once Russia has this communist revolution, there is this change in approach towards Russia. There's a much more of a sort of cautious approach towards what Russia's real agenda is. Wilson, on the one hand, is sympathetic with the American working class movement, but he also wants to make sure that American investments in Russia are protected. There were many railroad connections in Russia that, especially in Siberia, that Wilson wanted to protect. So he actually sent U.S. troops into northern and eastern Russia to try to protect them. Another thing is that Russia entered into a separate peace with Germany, which really enraged the Allies. This treaty was called the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, or Litovsk, and basically it meant that Russia and Germany entered into a peace agreement before the war actually ended. And this was enraging to Britain, France, and the United States, because now all of a sudden it seemed like Russia and Germany were willing to get along, even though Germany was clearly the enemy for the Allies at the same time. The U.S. troops that are in Russia are also trying to stop the Bolsheviks, so the Russian Civil War that took place, the U.S. is involved on the side of the White Russians, we like to call them, or the anti-Bolsheviks. So essentially what we see is, in the U.S., because of the Bolshevik Revolution, there is a small Red Scare after the First World War. We tend to think of the Red Scare as something that happened much more prominently after World War II with the advent of the Cold War, which is true, but it's important for us to realize that there was a Red Scare after World War I as well. So some of this is a response to the violence that took place in Russia. And also there was a continued presence of socialism and communism in the U.S. And with this increasing sense of xenophobia, you're going to have this major push to try to stop socialist and communist influence in the United States. So on the one hand, the Alien Act of 1918 acts as a justification to deport alleged radicals and non-U.S. citizens that are stirring up communist rhetoric. Business groups also start to use the anti-communist, anti-socialist rhetoric to try to keep unions out of factories. They see union organization as a sort of communist strategy. The other thing is that the Red Scare in some ways really destroyed the connections between women activists, because many of them were affiliated with socialist organizations. So the Russian Revolution and the subsequent Red Scare was another reason why socialism, communism, a lot of the sort of more working class activist movements effectively die after World War I. So what happens after World War I is over? In 1920, Warren G. Harding is going to be elected president. His campaign was literally to promote a return to normalcy. Warren Harding was arguing that all the happenings of the Progressive Era and World War I disrupted the traditional American life, and he promised that if he were elected, he would go back to that time of non-government intervention in the economy and political isolationism from foreign affairs like we had in the turn of the 20th century. So essentially, laissez-faire economics, isolationism, or what he pushed for. Because he was elected in 1920, we basically see the ceiling of the end of the Progressive Era. The 1920s, which we'll talk about obviously after this, is then going to be a period of little to no government intervention in the economy, a period that appears to be prosperous for those who are higher up in society, but in the background, farmers and racial and ethnic minorities were still struggling the entire time. So in a lot of ways, the alleged prosperity that emerged after the end of World War I were essentially a mask that didn't affect most of the population. And we probably should not have been as surprised as we were when the Great Depression struck. But in any case, even though the Progressive Era essentially ends with Warren G. Harding's election in 1920, the Progressive Era does leave an important legacy and makes it easier for the government to become increasingly involved in the economy during the Great Depression with the New Deal programs. So that is our overview on World War I and some of the events that were taking place at home. Again, just to really stress the idea that you must be familiar not only with what's happening abroad during World War I, but you really need to know how World War I affected the home front. So I tried to balance those evenly. So when we return from our much-deserved February break, we'll talk about World War I fairly briefly, and then we'll launch right into the 20s and the Great Depression. Thanks so much for listening.